Ramses II was the fourth king of the 19th dynasty, 1292-1225 BC, and the son of Seti I. He was pure black. He had thick lips and a broad nose, like the people of Western Sudan today. He was a warlike pharaoh, industrious and energetic, ruling Egypt for 67 years. In the early years of his reign, he engaged in the important campaign against the Hittites. At Kadesh, near Syria, the battle was indecisive. Finally, he signed a permanent peace treaty with the king of the Hittites, married the king's daughter, and the remaining years of his life were relatively peaceful. Ramses II is also known for his national public work projects, because these projects required the forced labor of thousands of Hebrew slaves. He is known as the Pharaoh of the oppression. He was a boastful, vainglorious, tyrannical personality who sought to astound humanity by covering the country with megalithic structures. This Ramses transferred the capital to the Nile Delta. The black Jews constructed the treasure cities, Python and Ramses. Ramses developed the Nile Delta and had the slaves build Egypt's megaliths. The colonnade at Luxor and its gigantic pylon, in front of which he placed six colossal statues of himself. Each of these statues was almost 60 feet high. Ramses II erased his predecessors' names from the records and substituted his own. This Ramses also constructed the hypostyle hall at Karnak and the temple called the Ramessean near Thebes. During this period, Egypt enjoyed a high degree of prosperity, a great boom just before the recession. When Merneptah, the son of Ramses II, came to the throne, the entire empire was falling apart. Moses entered Egypt probably during the reign of Ramses II or Meneptah. Moses, was commissioned by the God of Israel to go down into Egypt and to tell Pharaoh to let his people go. Moses did not have any great difficulty entering the palace of Pharaoh. He had been reared in the king's palace, and he knew Egyptian protocol. He decided to enter the palace at the time that Pharaoh was entertaining various ambassadors from foreign nations. After Egypt was weakened and terrified by the scourge of the 10 plagues, Pharaoh agreed to emancipate the Hebrew slaves. Beginning with the reign of Merneptah and the kings of the 20th dynasty, Egypt was in a state of decline. There were revolts throughout the empire. It is evident that the emancipation of the Hebrew slaves may have triggered these revolts, producing a chain reaction. Weakness at home and attack from the external enemies marked the defeat and decline of the empire. In the 10th century BC, the Libyans invaded Egypt and established the 22nd Bubastite dynasty. Under the Libyan dynasty, Egypt tried to revive the empire. Sheshonq, or Sheshnak, invaded Palestine and entered into combat with the Davidic dynasty. At this time, most of Shishak's troops were Libyans and Cushites. After 200 years of Libyan rule, the Cushites invaded Egypt and the Middle East, making themselves a great power. Then the Assyrians, Babylonians, Persians, Greeks, Romans, and Arabs invaded Egypt consecutively, terminating Egyptian rule. Kush, Ethiopia. The ancient country of Kush was in eastern Sudan region of Africa. During the Middle Ages, the Sudan was not united and organized as a single country. The Afro-Asian world considered the Sudan to be the territory extending from the Sahara Desert almost to the equator, its widest part nearly 1,000 miles. Also, it extended from the Atlantic Ethiopic Ocean to the highlands of Ethiopia in the east, its longest part about 4,000 miles. This vast area includes such countries as the modern Sudan, Chad, Niger, Mali, Guinea, Senegal, Gambia, Upper Volta, etc. During the colonial period, this area was divided into two parts called the French Sudan in the west and the Anglo-Egyptian Sudan in the east. The word Sudan is an Arabic word meaning black. The Arabs called this vast area Bilad es-Sudan, the territory of the black, because the tribes here were very black, unmixed tribes. In dealing with the Kingdom of Kutch, we find that it is located in the eastern Sudan near the Red Sea. The country of Kutch was situated on both sides of the Nile River between the third and sixth cataract. The modern nation called the Sudan occupies this territory. The important cities of ancient Kutch were Nabata, Meroe, Masuwarat, Kuru, Kurgas, and Naga. There were two civilizations of the Ethiopian people in the continent of Africa. One was in the highlands of Ethiopia, with its capital at Aksum. The second was located in the region of the present-day Sudan, with its capital at Nabata, and at other times at Meroe. The people in the ancient country of Kutch were called Nuba, or Nubians, as subnames. Other subnames they used are Behas or Besharin, which are sub-tribes. These people, it would be corrected to say, are northern Ethiopians who lived in the Sudan. European writers make a practice of calling various tribes in Africa by the infamous name Negroes. True Africans are indeed Africans regardless of what they look like. The Africans have their own tribal names, and they do not need the European appellations of Negritians, Negroes, Negrelos, or Negroids. Kutchite Conquest. When the power of the Libyan kings of Egypt began to wane in the 8th century, the northern Ethiopian king, Pianchi, marched from his capital of Nabata and invaded Egypt. The Kutchite kings of Nabata and Meroe were subservient to the Egyptian crown for over 1,000 years. They paid tribute mostly in gold, ivory, slaves, cattle, and fighting men. At this time, the Ethiopians were brazen enough to challenge the world's greatest empire. Pianchi's elite troops and his mighty naval forces attacked city after city until they reached Memphis. Hermopolis fell before him. Even the capital of Asarkon III at Heliopolis could not withstand his advances. The enemy capitulated at the capital, and the supremacy of Ethiopia was established in Egypt. Roger says that Pianchi sailed for his home in the south, his ships laden with silver, gold, copper, clothing, and everything of the north lands. Every product of Syria, and all the sweet woods of God's land. His Majesty sailed upstream with a glad heart. The shores on either side were jubilating, west and east singing, O mighty ruler, Pianchi, thou comest having gained the dominion of the north. About 712 BC, there arose another king, Ethiopian, over the city of Nabata. This new king was called Shabaka, or Shabakon, the brother of Pianchi. He established the 25th Ethiopian dynasty in Egypt. According to Manetho, he burned Boukiris alive, the alleged ruler of the 24th dynasty. During the long history of the Middle East, there have always been wars between the military powers north of the land of Israel by way of Syria and the military powers south of Israel, Egypt. Israel was the Bissaf Bain Hotpatish Vihasadan, the egg between the hammer and the anvil. In the time of Ahaz and Hezekiah, the kings of Judah, Assyria and Egypt were the great powers. Both of these powers had threatened the independence of the little state of Judah, but with the help of God, she survived. The prophet Isaiah had told King Ahaz to stand still and do nothing. In other words, Isaiah meant, do not make any alliances with Assyria or Egypt, but trust in the God of Israel. One of the most famous generals of Shabaka was Taharqa, or Tirhaka, the son of Pianchi. This Ethiopian general advanced against Sennacherib, the king of Assyria, while the Assyrians were threatening the existence of Judah. Taharqa captured Philistia in the year 688 BC, but was defeated at Eltekeh, west of Jerusalem, by the Assyrians. Also, Taharqa was the third king in the 25th Egyptian dynasty, 715-663. At first, he defeated Esarhaddon, but 3 years later, 671, he was expelled from the city of Memphis and never returned. Ethiopia, this African state, became a great power, even though it was only for a period of 100 years. If Assyria had not emerged when she did, Ethiopia probably would have lasted another 100 years as a Western Mediterranean power. Because the Ethiopians were defeated by the Assyrians, we must not conclude that their existence and influence was stifled or choked out. Indeed, Roger says that Natsasin, a later king of the Ethiopians, defeated the great Persian conqueror Cambyses in 525 BC. At this time, the Ethiopians continued to exercise a political and economic influence over the African tribes to the south and the west. In the same way that culture and civilization spread from Greece and Rome over the entire continent of Europe, in the same manner, culture and civilization spread from Egypt and Ethiopia to other parts of the continent of Africa. It seems that the Kushite civilization developed in two stages, first at the famous city of Nabata, and the second at the industrial city of Meroe. The political power of Nabata was predicated on the affluence of gold. Here is an excellent description of the abundance of gold in Ethiopia. Cambyses trusts his authorities far up the Nile, past Thebes and the first cataract into Ethiopia. This exotic country aroused the curiosity of the Persians with its elephants and ivory and gold. They said that the prisoners in Ethiopia wore fetters of gold. Ethiopian domination on the Nile began to rise after the decline of the Libyan king of Egypt during the 10th century. Kashta was one of the greatest kings of Nabata. He began the conquest of Egypt, with which his son Pianchi continued. The city of Nabata was located inside the river bend between the 3rd and 4th cataract. History is witness to the fact that the greatest civilizations developed alongside riverbanks, and so it was with the Ethiopian cities of Nabata and Meroe. Meroe was a greater city than Nabata. It was located between the 5th and 6th cataracts and between the Nile and the Atbara rivers. Meroe is a very ancient city. As you have read, Moses the Hebrew led an Egyptian army against it about 1350 BC. Obviously, it was standing when Thutmose I, 1540-1501, established his southern frontier in Ethiopian territory. This frontier was located past Nabata, almost to the 5th cataract, between 595 and 550. The capital of Kush was transferred from Nabata to Meroe. The primary motive for the transference was because of the Persian attacks against Ethiopia after 595 BC. Two other reasons probably contributed to the removal of the capital. One, the city of Meroe was surrounded by grassland containing scattered trees. Two, there were large deposits of iron ore found in this area. The iron ore rendered a great impetus to the civilization of Kush and other African tribes. L. Rogers, F. Adams, and W. Brown, European writers, state that there is evidence that in the days when Europeans were still satisfied with rude stone tools, the Africans had invented the art of smelting iron. Excavators have even found the furnaces in which the iron ore was smelted, and they have found mountains of iron slag. Retention of Kushite identity. Although the Egyptians dominated parts of Ethiopia for over 1,000 years, the Ethiopians, to a great extent, maintained their own identity, ideas, and customs. The Kushites were never absorbed nationally into the Egyptian social structure. It has been postulated by some authorities that the pharaohs of the 25th Ethiopian dynasty accepted Egyptian gods. Nevertheless, these kings were interred in the tombs in a position that accorded with Ethiopian tradition, but not according to Egyptian customs. After the year 500 BC, there emerged a more distinctive Kushite culture similar to a Kushite Renaissance. The gods are the gods of Meroe, not Egypt. The stone ram, symbolic of the power of the god Amun, stood outside the temple of Naga, a Kushite city. The Meroites employed the Egyptian hieroglyphic writing in their temple, but after 225 BC, they devised their own alphabet even before Rome became a great power. They began to create fine pottery with their own original styles. Also, they constructed majestic temples and palaces of beautiful design. Many of the ruins of ancient Kushite are still standing at Meroe, Masuwarat, Naga, and near Napata. Basil Davidson says these sites are waiting for more archaeologists, with time and money to be excavated. The Kushites built a powerful empire in Africa that extended far and wide. Their political and military sway extended to the Red Sea, to the Aksumite Kingdom, to the south. Evidence has been found that Ethiopian influence extended to Lake Chad and to the Uganda territory. There was even trade with Arabia, India, China, Egypt, Aksum, and the neighboring tribes. Kush was no playboy on the international stage, but was recognized and known among the greatest powers of the day. The Ethiopians fought successive wars with the Egyptians, Hebrews, Assyrians, Persians, and under the Aksumite kingdom, they fought the Arabians. Kush was a sophisticated power, and during her greatness, she became the mistress of the south. The greatness of Ethiopia is written in the annals of the ancient nations. She dispatched her ambassadors to the known nations of her day. Herodotus, the Greek historian, knew little about the Ethiopians. Furthermore, he did not visit this intriguing land. When Herodotus heard of this land, he called the people Aethiops. In the Greek language, this word means burnt face. He never called them by their national name, which is Kush. Finally, the civilization in the highlands of ancient Ethiopia at Aksum began to rise. King Ezana of Aksum marched down to the city of Meroe and attacked it, putting an end to its greatness. The causes of the war between Meroe and Aksum probably were trade competition and the influx of Nubians from the Sahara. The Black African Hebrews of Egypt and Ethiopia. From what period can we certify the existence of Black Hebrews in Egypt and Ethiopia? It is certain that Israelites were in Egypt and Ethiopia during the period of King Takhlot of Egypt, 23rd Tanite Dynasty, about 725 BC, and the prophet Isaiah of Jerusalem, because we read in Isaiah chapter 11, verse 11, that, "And it shall come to pass in the day that the Lord shall set his hand again the second time to recover the remnant of his people, which shall be left from Assyria and from Egypt and from Patros, Upper Egypt, and from Cush, Ethiopia." In Isaiah 27, verse 13, we get the understanding that the outcasts of Judah are in the land of Egypt. In chapter 19, verse 18, the prophet is positive that 5 cities with Jews and Egyptian converts will accept the God of Israel and will speak the language of Canaan, Hebrew. About 70 years after Isaiah, the prophet Zephaniah, chapter 3, verse 10, says, "From beyond the river of Ethiopia, my suppliants, even the daughter of my dispersed, shall bring mine offering." Many authorities have agreed that Zephaniah was speaking concerning the Jews who were dispersed and who colonized the region in and around Ethiopia. Since the Hebrew prophets and historians, for example, Josephus, knew that the Jews were in Egypt and Ethiopia, the next question is what are some of the theories concerning their arrival in these countries? The theories are as follows. King Solomon married the daughter of the king of Egypt. Obviously, this marriage was for the economical and political reasons. 1 Kings chapter 11 verse 1. Solomon wanted to maintain international peace, security, and commerce. It is probable that he arranged with Pharaoh, his father-in-law, to establish Jewish trade colonies on the Nile River. By the way, Solomon married the daughters of many kings to keep them under his economic and political control. In 1 Kings chapter 9 verse 26, we read that King Solomon made a navy of ships in Ezion-Geber, which is beside Eloth, on the shore of the Red Sea, in the land of Edom. And Hiram, the king of Tyre, or Phoenicia, sent in the navy his servants, shipmen that had knowledge of the sea, with the servants of Solomon, and they came to Ophir, and fetched from thence gold, 420 talents, and brought it to the king Solomon. Many scholars have postulated that the land of Ophir is on the east coast of Africa. This would be in Ethiopia territory. It would appear highly probable that Solomon would establish trade colonies along the east and west coast of the Red Sea. Ancient Ethiopia had excessive gold deposits to satisfy Solomon's need. As has been mentioned previously, the Persian troops of Cambyses said the prisoners in Ethiopia wore fetters of gold. The Queen of Sheba visited Solomon. The fact that her visit occurs often, the voyage of Solomon Hiram's navy to Ophir suggests that, in the mind of the writer, Ophir was associated with the territory of that rich Queen of Sheba. Apparently, when the navy of Solomon came to Ophir, the Queen of Sheba heard about the greatness of Solomon. Josephus, the Jewish historian, certified the fact that Queen of Sheba was the Queen of Egypt and Ethiopia. This would mean that Jewish trade colonies were established in her territory. Josephus also says that the royal city of the Ethiopians was Saba or Sheba. The two words are interchangeable. According to the Ethiopians and the black Jews of this country, the Queen of Sheba gave birth to a son of whom they say Solomon was the father. Moreover, they say that other black Jews accompanied the queen back to Ethiopia. The name of the child to whom she gave birth was Menelik. Years later, as the story is related, Menelik returned to Jerusalem for his education. On his return trip to Ethiopia, Solomon sent along with him some leading priests and officers. All these events occurred during the 10th century BC. This was probably the first organized Jewish colony in Ethiopia. In this same century, Sheshak, the king of Egypt, invaded Palestine. 1 Kings chapter 14 verse 25. Without doubt, he must have transported many Jews to Egypt and Ethiopia because he took prisoners with him, and his army consisted of Libyans and Ethiopians. During the late part of the 8th or the early part of the 7th century, the Ethiopians' general Terhaka invaded Palestine and captured more than a few towns. The prophet Isaiah certainly knew what he was talking about. Then he spoke of the Israelites' exiles in Tirhaka's country at that time. Even the advance of the mighty Assyrian army would motivate many Israelites to take refuge in Egypt, Libya, and Ethiopia. Again, the incursions of the powerful army of King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon in the years 698-675 into Palestine undoubtedly caused rapid and numerous migratory waves of Israelites to flee into North and East Africa. In Jeremiah chapter 44, verse 1, the prophet addresses the Jews in Egypt and the Jews that live in Patros, which is southern Egypt. Jeremiah tells the Jews in the 11th verse that they are not safe from Nebuchadnezzar. This warning would naturally influence many Jews to migrate deeper into Ethiopia and the Sahara Desert. By the time of the prophet Zephaniah, about 630 BC, Ethiopia and the adjacent lands of Uganda and Kenya were swarming with black Jews. Zephaniah says, chapter 3, verse 10, "From beyond the rivers of Ethiopia my suppliants, even the daughter of my dispersed, shall bring mine offering." This verse is an indication that the Israelites would be multiplying and making converts among the inhabitants beyond the rivers of Ethiopia. No doubt this prophet had communication with the Jews in this remote area. The rivers of Ethiopia connect with the Nile water system in the heart of Ethiopia. The Atbara River extends from the highlands of modern Ethiopia to the Nile. The Blue Nile extends from the direction of Addis Ababa in a northwestern direction towards the Nile. Near Uganda and the northern Congo is the Bahr el-Ghazal River. It is 500 miles long. In southwest Sudan, formed by the confluence of the Bahr el-Arab and Jur rivers in northwest Upper Nile. It flows east to unite at Lait No with the Bahr in El Jebel and form the White Nile. These areas are beyond the rivers of Ethiopia. Moreover, are there any records or oral traditions of the existence of Jews tribes deeply beyond the rivers of Ethiopia? Joseph Williams cites a particular case. He said, "There can be little doubt but that somewhere in the dim past, probably by way of Abyssinia, a wave of Hebraic culture penetrated to the Lake District of East Africa, if we may credit the following citations. Speaking of Uganda to the west of Lake Victoria and northeast of the Belgian Congo, it has an organized native government with a tradition of 33 kings and a legendary line that traces back to King David. It is a proud history the legends tell of Uganda. People crossing the Nile remember beyond the rivers of Ethiopia. Centuries upon centuries ago, and subduing all tribes whose country they traversed, they claimed the highest native civilization in Africa." The above report is highly credible in all its details if we keep in mind what I have written pertaining to the Egyptians and Cushite Jews. The thing that might be questioned about the Uganda people is not their identity, but the vitality of the Jewishness of their religion. Tabiban, Kamant, and Wasambara Jews. Professor Ellen S. Gobe says that the word Tabiban means smiths. He has located these Jews in central Ethiopia. The Tabiban Jews were really Falashas, but they were forced to accept a normal Christianity. They were like the Murano Jews of Spain, forced to accept a religion against their will. The word Falasha in Amharic, the official language of Ethiopia, means immigrant. The Falashas did not call themselves by this name. They used the name Beit Israel, the House of Israel. But the Abyssinians called them Falashas because the other tribes in Ethiopia called the House of Israel Falashas or immigrants. This would suggest that perhaps the Falasha Jews came to Abyssinia at a later date. Therefore, they were ostracized because they did not accept Christianity. The Falashas held the monopoly on the skilled trades in Ethiopia. They were leather workers, potters, smiths, and masons. The Kamant Jews were separated into two classes. The Keberti, honored, from these the priests are chosen, and the Yetanti, small or insignificant people. By the way, these two classes were called by names that are similar to the Hebrew. The Kamant Jew esteems Moses highly and many other Old Testament personalities. They observe Yom Kippur and the feast for the dead. because they remain isolated from other Jews, Christian, and pagans. They learn very little from the external world. About 1,300 miles south of the territory of the Falashas live the Wasambara people. They are a variety of colors from light brown to black. In their land are found asylum, institutions, cities of refuge. They are like the Levitical cities found in the Old Testament. Professor Godbey says, taken with sacrifices, wherever Judaism is acknowledged, there must have been introduced by Yemenite or Himyaritic Jews traders in very ancient times. Concerning the Wasambara people along the east coast of Africa, opposite the land of Zanzibar, we know very little, but it is a known fact among scholars that Jewish merchants from Yemen traded along that coast. It is possible that the Jewish colonies were established there at an early date. It is also a probability that Jewish tribes migrated from the north. I have shown previously that Jewish immigrants crossed the Red Sea into Ethiopia, and that Jewish immigrants migrated from Egypt to Ethiopia. My conclusion is this. The nation of Ethiopia became a confluence or crossroad of a wave of Hebrew culture and settlements. Here in Ethiopia was the great center of the black Jews. They exchanged ideas, some settled down to stay, others departed the west and south. Joseph L. Williams, quoting Walter Chicchile Plowden, the British consul in Abyssinia, agrees with my conclusion. After the British consul reviewed the national records and traditions, he concluded, two things are certain, that at a far later period, six sovereigns of pure Jewish race and faith reigned at Gondar, and that to this day numerous Jews are found throughout Abyssinia. I think it is also highly probable that, at whatever epoch it may be placed, the whole of Abyssinia was of Jewish persuasion, previous to its conversion, as even those who have adopted the Christian creed still maintain numerous forms and observances. As we can conclude from the above and the other records, the Christians of Abyssinia were once Jews. Incidentally, Solomon Grazel, in his book A History of the Jews, has stated that there still exist 100,000 black Jews in Ethiopia who are not Christians. After King Abraha of Ethiopia accepted Christianity in the 4th century AD, a great change occurred that was disastrous to the existence of the Jews. They became victims of persecution that lasted for many centuries. Ever since the rise of Christianity in Ethiopia, Judaism has been decreasing. Yet in spite of social pressures and discrimination, 100,000 black Jews have been able to survive. This multitude of Jews surviving under hostile conditions proves their greater numerical strength earlier in their history. The Jews of Malagasy Republic. There is an island near the southeastern coast of Africa called Malagasy Republic. The old name for this island was Madagascar. Near the eastern part of this island, on the Isles of St. Mary, there exists a group of black Jews who call themselves Zafin Ibrahim, descendants of Abraham. Professor Alan H. Gubay says that the same alphabetic writing that was present in Palestine about 650 BC appeared at the same time in Malaysia. Moreover, he says since the Hovas of Madagascar are members of the Malayan family who probably immigrated from Cambodia, this indicates the historical connection with the Jews of Madagascar. Like the Jews of Ethiopia, Uganda, and Wasambara, there are a multiplicity of Jewish cultures, survivals, complexes, patterns, and traits found functioning among the Jews of Madagascar, such as the following. The day counted from sunset to sunset, many fast days, the eating of beef, the New Year festival, the making of a small fire on the first evening of the feast. They have rituals of the purification of the people. They sprinkle blood of the New Year's ritual upon the doorpost. The latter ritual could be reminiscent of the Passover ceremony, which is observed in the month of Abib. This month is the first month of the Jewish civil New Year. In this month, the kings of Israel were inaugurated. The North African Black Jews. In the year 331, that Alexander the Great defeated the Persian Emperor Darius at the Battle of Gaugamela, incorrectly called Arbela, a new master emerged on the world stage and transformed the history and culture of three continents. However, Alexander died in the prime of his life at the age of 32 because of debauchery and intoxication. Before the death of Alexander, his desire was to establish a Eurasian state. His scheme was to amalgamate the Greeks with the Asians. This was implemented by the widespread marriage of his troops with the colored women of the East. Most of his troops remained in the subjugated countries and became absorbed into the native population. After the death of Alexander, his vast empire was divided among his generals. Ptolemy received Egypt and Seleucus received Asia. As time elapsed, there was constant war between these two dynasties. By the year 198 BC, the descendants of General Seleucus had their capital in Syria, just north of Palestine. In the same year, the Seleucid dynasty in Syria compelled Egypt to give up Palestine, the land of the Jews. The king of Syria at the time was Antiochus III. When Antiochus IV usurped the throne in Syria, 175-163 BC, he entertained the thought of uniting Alexander's empire. This meant the conquest of Egypt. However, the province that bordered on Egypt was Palestine, which stood in his way. At this time, the Jews would not accept Greek culture. Nevertheless, Antiochus was determined to Hellenize the Jews. The army of Antiochus marched into Palestine to support Menelaus, the leader of the pro-Syrian party. As a result, many Jews were killed. Others escaped to the hills and to Egypt. Only those Jews that supported Antiochus' policies remained in Jerusalem. An edict was promulgated interdicting the observance of the holidays, the Shabbat, and circumcision. A statue of Jupiter was erected in the holy temple above the altar. To this statue, the people brought the sacrifices of pig meat, the animal which is an abomination to the Jews. Because of this religious persecution, the legitimate high priest, Onias III, and many other Jews fled into Africa. Countries such as Egypt, Ethiopia, and Cyrenaica, Libya. Throughout the last 2,500 years, the main factors that have contributed to the social migration of the Jews were wars, religious persecutions, and commerce. All these factors were operating and gave rise to the African Jewish population.